Welcome to iPad Pros, the show all about using your iPad to be productive and get work done. I'm Tim Chen, host of the show.
So I wanted to see if I could make a case that had different design trade-offs compared to the other cases on the market. So I said, let me create a case that makes different design trade-offs to currently what's there. So one thing you'll notice is that it offers you to not just type in landscape mode, but also portrait mode. There's actually a stand that's built in. I made the cutout so that you could take the iPad out, rotate it, and type as if you're typing on a piece of paper.
Welcome back to another episode of iPad Pros. I'm excited to share with you today the very first in-person interview I've conducted for the show. For the past 2 weeks, I've been using the TouchType Pro keyboard case with the Loner 3rd generation 11-inch iPad Pro. In just a few minutes, you'll hear from the creator, Salman Sajid. Before we dive into the interview, I want to share just a few thoughts on both the 3rd gen iPad Pro and the TouchType Pro. First off, on the iPad. The biggest revelation to me was just how great Face ID is when using it to unlock your password keychain in Safari. That was the moment for me that Face ID really made me say, wow, this really is a beneficial change and something that is really freaking great. Next up was just the sensation of holding the iPad in my hand without a case. That reminded me so much of the original 2010 iPad. It's the first time we've had flat edges since that original design, and holding it in your hand really does remind you of that feeling. And just for fun, I grabbed that old iPad and compared the two side by side, and yeah, they felt almost identical outside of a little bulge in the original one with the curve that was kind of built into it. I'm still not sure if I prefer the feeling of the second generation Pro in my hand with those thinner edges, but they are very different experiences just holding them. The other thing I want to share is that I do like the gesture bar overall, but wish some applications gave you a bit more control over it. The biggest disappointment for me was how distracting it was when using Apple Books. When all I want to do is focus on my book and read, that gesture bar shows up every time you turn the page. I can't imagine a more irritating implementation than what they chose to do for Apple Books, I'm sure the Kindle app as well. So I would just really appreciate and love if in iOS 13 there was some option for applications to have the gesture bar remain more hidden, more so than it is right now. So those were my big takeaways from the 3rd generation iPad Pro. I love that you can hold it in any orientation, and there is no right or wrong way. In fact, I did get confused a little bit. Where is the sleep button? Oh, it's on the other side because I thought I was holding it the other way. And that was a really cool thing to experience. But those were my big takeaways from the 3rd gen iPad Pro. There were some things much better than the 2nd gen, some things just different, some things I didn't like as much. So there are a lot of trade-offs in deciding which iPad to opt for. Now, on to the TouchType case, which you can find at touchtypecase.com, and the Kickstarter is linked there as well. The Kickstarter does end Friday, May 17th at noon Eastern, so if you're listening to this episode, don't delay in reserving yours. Overall, I was really impressed with this case. I found it just as comfortable using it in my lap as my current smart keyboard setup with my iPad Pro. I loved having the Magic Keyboard be this portable. It's a great keyboard, and traveling with it is not always the best. Here's who I'd recommend this case for. If you are someone that wants to have a setup that works both for a desk and for traveling, then this solution is a good one. While traveling, you can use it in its traditional setup and even use the iPad Pro to charge the Magic Keyboard over USB-C. When you are at your desk, you can separate the keyboard from the case and have a bit more of an ergonomic desk setup without needing a different keyboard. And it really does disconnect just like you would a smart cover, which is a really cool thing. Another really nice thing about the TouchType is when you close the smart cover lid down because of the magnets, the screen will actually turn off, making sure there is no accidental input there. I'd encourage everyone to head on over to touchtypecase.com and clicking over to the Kickstarter to watch the video, which will give you a really good idea if you would enjoy this form factor. As mentioned in the interview, this isn't the lightest and thinnest solution out there, but if you are someone that really loves the Magic Keyboard, this is a great solution, and having it with you all the time is pretty awesome. As a reminder, you can support the podcast by leaving a review over at Apple Podcasts or by heading over to patreon.com/iPadPros. With that, here's my interview with Salman Sagat. Enjoy.
Welcome to the podcast, Salman.
Hi, thanks for having me, Tim.
So I've had the opportunity to use your case for about 2 weeks now and the new iPad, and thanks for letting me borrow both of those.
Yeah, no problem.
So can you first introduce yourself and kind of what got you into keyboard cases and that whole story?
Yeah, so my name is Salman Sajid. I've been a user interface designer for over 20 years now. Back then, back in the 90s, like Apple was in a very dark place. I wasn't so much into sports, so Apple became my underdog that I follow. You know? So I saw them make decision by decision, you know, jobs came back and start turning things around. By the time the iPhone hit, mm-hmm. and the home runs that were coming out, I desperately wanted to be a part of that world.
Yeah.
I said somehow I want to participate in this revival. Then the iPad came out, and you'll note in the keynote, Jobs never mentions it can connect to a Bluetooth keyboard.
Right.
That was something that everyone learned on launch day.
Yeah.
And fortunately, I was able to pick up the first generation iPad on launch day. A lot of blogs are talking about it can connect to an external keyboard, and I thought to myself, so what's to keep this from being like a laptop? Well, you need some way to combine a keyboard, a Bluetooth keyboard, to the iPad. And I said, let me focus on the Apple wireless keyboard.
Sure.
So that same weekend, I went to the local pharmacy, got some poster board, some duct tape, and made a prototype.
And this was in the days where the Apple wireless keyboard was a little bit thicker. It had this like rounded kind of battery barrel to it.
Yeah, exactly. So it had a slightly different form factor, but the idea was the same.
Yeah.
Was that since it's a touch device, you didn't necessarily want to have it where the keyboard would fold on top of the screen, especially since these were hard plastics, that it could potentially damage it. Mm-hmm. So I said, let's do something different. Let's put the keyboard behind the iPad. The rest was pretty easy. You just, create a wraparound cover, and it gives you many abilities as well as using in your lap. You can do in multiple angles. That's how the touch type case was born.
So that was the original iPad. How has that design kind of changed over the years, and how have you refined it to what it is now for the new third generation Pros?
Yeah, so that was my main core idea. Mm-hmm. And I knew to do it properly, I really needed to invest in plastics to really create a nice sleek shell for it that could connect together. But as being just a single guy, doesn't know this world at all, no real capital, to speak of, I decided to take what's called like a minimal viable product approach, where I created a sleeve for the keyboard where it would slide behind the iPad rather than flip behind the iPad.
Yeah.
It didn't involve plastics, could make it, get it made relatively cheaply, well, with less capital. So I focused on that and launched it on Kickstarter in 2012.
Okay.
And I was honestly a little bit surprised by the reaction. Like, to me, it was just like a little experiment, but there was a lot of positive press coverage. Even afterwards, the backers, once they got it in their hands, they said it changed the way I use my iPad.
Mm-hmm.
In that span of time, from 2010 to 2012, other keyboard cases came out, but they were the more traditional laptop style.
Sure.
And since the iPad was narrower than a full-size keyboard, the mm-hmm. keyboards were also narrow to accommodate.
Yep.
And that's what really killed me, was that, look, this is supposed to be the future of computing.
Let's not slap netbook keyboards on.
Right. So this is the future, is where your hands are cramped and your typing speeds are compromised, right? Yeah. It's not like our hands magically shrunk when the iPad was announced. Mm-hmm. So why did our keyboards?
Yeah.
Right? So that thought stuck with me.
Right.
That if you really wanted to use the iPad for a work device, then put a work-grade keyboard on it.
And thankfully, iPads have grown a little bit over the years, and they have the 12.9 that's like a perfect fit for the Magic Keyboard.
Right, exactly. So yeah, now, thankfully, fast forward to now, the 12.9, because they shaved off the chins mm-hmm, the latest versions, I was just really pleasantly surprised to see that there's no overhang, and it just looks like they're meant to go together.
Yeah. So what's your relationship with keyboards? Have you been a clicky keyboard person? Do you like Apple's keyboards mostly? Or what's your experience with all that?
Yeah. So I wouldn't consider myself a keyboard connoisseur, but more around what's the best keyboard that enables me to translate the intent in my head on the screen in the most efficient way possible.
Yeah.
So for me, the Magic Keyboard really hits that sweet spot.
Right.
Because it's just enough travel. It's not too much travel and it's not too little. Like, you know, mm-hmm. and we see examples on both sides, right?
Yeah.
You have the Apple's latest laptops that are, I think, a little bit too little travel.
Yeah.
And it has enough tactile feedback so I feel that, okay, I've pressed that key and I can move on.
Yeah.
So I don't really foresee, like, you know, how much more. To me, it's the pinnacle. I've seen both extremes, and I don't expect moving away from the Apple Magic keyboard anytime soon.
Yeah. It'll be curious the future of keyboards with Apple. If they'll just do... Your next laptop's just two screens in the bottom.
Right.
Screen's a keyboard down there.
Some sci-fi movie, right?
Right, yeah. Yeah, and the back to like the best keyboard for the job. In some cases, you just want a number pad to do input for...
Exactly.
In music composition, that'd be, four equals a quarter note when you have a MIDI keyboard.
That's right.
Two, and...
Yeah, because these keyboards, remember, they're not the end in themselves, right?
Right.
They're meant to serve a purpose.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, if you want... Otherwise, play an instrument, you know, because that's what you're doing.
Yeah.
But here, it's just to do a job and to interact with the device.
So your design priorities with this case obviously involved Magic Keyboard.
Right.
What else were you considering when making this?
Right. So another thing was that I looked at how the iPad was designed.
Mm-hmm.
The iPad was meant to be versatile.
Yeah.
Everything from its orientations to from even like, you know, the software and how it kind of adapts to you.
Especially this iPad, the third gen, where in using this, this is the first time me using the 11-inch iPad.
Yeah.
Many times I was holding it in one orientation and I couldn't find the sleep button because it was on the bottom.
Right.
Because it does such a good job fooling you because it doesn't matter anymore.
You forget about it. Yeah, and I love that. So I wanted to see if I could make a case that had different design trade-offs compared to the other cases on the
mm-hmm.
market.
Yep.
Right? Because my bet was that the iPad is a large market right now, and it's actually a growing market.
Right.
When you have a growing market, you have different people who have different needs with different trade-offs.
Yeah.
So I said, let me create a case that makes different design trade-offs to currently what's there. So
mm-hmm.
one thing you'll notice is that it offers you to not just type in landscape mode,
right,
but also portrait mode. There's actually a stand that's built in. I made the cutout so that you could take the iPad out, rotate it, and type as if you're typing on a piece of paper.
Yeah, and it's very stable. I've tapped and the iPad doesn't fall
exactly.
or anything.
Exactly, you're right. You know, and that's not something that you can get with other cases right now.
Yeah.
The other aspect was if you're using your iPad, say, with a keyboard case, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then say you want to just do FaceTime or you want to watch a movie. Well, there's nothing, you can't do anything with the keyboard. It's kind of stuck there,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep.
and look, it's staring at you while you're trying to not think about work.
Yeah.
So with this case, you can actually flip the keyboard behind the iPad.
Right.
In those instances that you just want to focus on the iPad and just forget that it's even there.
Or yank the keyboard off entirely.
And that's the other one, right? You can even go a step further and actually detach the keyboard because there's magnets in the tray that connect the keyboard to the iPad so that you can actually pull them apart.
Yeah, it feels like a smart cover how it connects.
Right, exactly. Yeah. The same. So there's actually alternating polarities of magnets in there so that they connect easily and they same way. You tug on the side and it disconnects just as easily. And this actually allows you, speaking of versatility, to work in different ways. So some
mm-hmm.
people, for ergonomic reasons, want to put the screen a bit higher.
Yeah.
If you can disconnect the keyboard with just a quick tug, then you can actually lift and put the iPad portion of the case on a stand.
Yeah.
And continue working. And then when it's time to go, you connect them together and just put in your bag and get going.
You can also, get rid of wireless.
Yes.
And just plug in a lightning, the USB-C cable, which I have, and I tried this out.
Right.
And turned off Bluetooth and the iPad will talk and charge your keyboard. Yeah.
Yeah. So again, it's all about the versatility, right?
Mm-hmm.
And my bet is that there's enough people out there in the world. Maybe majority of people will like Apple solution. That's totally fine. But there must be enough people that say, hey, this, you know, their keyboard's too small or I want to do more things with it. Well, then here's one thing that they might find useful.
Yeah. And you do get access to the media keys, which can be pretty useful.
Yeah. Another design goal was to give a bit more protection
mm-hmm.
than is allowed, you know, than you see in most other cases. So that's why we've created a polycarbonate shell that protects
mm-hmm.
the corners.
Yep.
Another thing I've seen is that since, you know, finally Apple gave us a place to put the Apple Pencil.
Yeah.
Right? On the magnetically attaches on the side. But the problem is that when you're, you know, moving things around, it can easily knock off. and it's a
right.
It's not a cheap.
Yeah, you don't have the folio leather right. sleeve with the place that
exactly.
will be secure anymore.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly. So I wanted to make sure that it offers some protection,
mm-hmm.
so that it wouldn't fall off, and even again protects the corner from dings and things
yeah.
such as that. The other design goal was also like the looks,
mm-hmm.
right? I wanted it to look a bit different from the other iPad cases.
Yeah.
More in keeping what a business folio would look like.
Right.
So you'd look at it and you'd almost have to look twice again and say, oh, there's an iPad in there.
Yeah.
Something you feel proud of, like, you know, bringing into a meeting and kind of just popping it out and having everybody like, oh, wow. You know, like as if.
Yeah. And the leather does feel really nice. The sourcing materials, what
yeah.
was that process
so
like?
So that's, you know, it's interesting. Once you go into this world of manufacturing, and then you ask your manufacturer, all right, so how do I choose the leather or the material?
Yeah.
They give you swatches and swatches. I mean, just books and books of swatches.
Yeah.
Right? So you take the swatches, you pick your favorites, then you show it to your friends, you show it to your wife.
Yeah.
You know? And you just winnow it down. For this one, you know, so we wanted to keep something professional, but also a bit different.
Mm-hmm.
So yes, it's black, which is a very popular color. I mean,
right.
it goes with everything, obviously.
Yeah.
But it has a little bit of subtlety that you won't find in
mm-hmm.
other cases. And one is that there's almost like a brushed steel sheen that's
yeah.
in it.
Right.
So that when you know, move it in the light, it kind
mm-hmm.
of reflects in a
yeah.
kind of almost metallic fashion. It's a vegan leather. It's not real leather. But this also allows it to be, you know, be cleaned easily. If water gets on or anything gets on it, you can
yeah.
easily wipe it off.
What do you expect for durability with the material?
Yeah. So I'm really fortunate in that the manufacturer I'm working with is like one of the main manufacturers for some larger brands of iPad
mm-hmm.
cases
yeah.
That are currently like in Best Buy and, you know, Walmart and I think even the Apple Store. This materials that they've been using to make this case are the same ones that they've honed over years. Like even the resin or the adhesive
mm-hmm.
is applied with a hot glue melt process. And the actual, they're telling me that it's like a biodegradable, it's environmentally friendly, but
yeah.
also it's holds up secure. And they
okay.
haven't had any problems with any of the other cases that they've made in the same fashion.
Okay.
That said, this is a version 1.0 product.
Right.
right? So, you know, Apple's version 1.0 products, they always have, you know, there's always things that could be better.
Right.
I'm just grateful that, you know, people like the idea enough to give it a try, and hopefully from their feedback, it'll continue to improve.
Yeah, definitely. So who do you see this case being for? You
right.
mentioned it's pretty versatile.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So just like in anything in life, right? Everything has trade-offs, and it's very difficult to have everything and give up nothing.
Yeah.
So if there was, say, for example, there's a target market, like a, you know, like a dartboard, the bullseye for this case would be people who already love the Magic Keyboard and are already using the Magic Keyboard with their iPad.
Mm-hmm.
Because it allows them to take the same setup they have and do more with it.
Yeah.
Right? Now they can put it on their lap.
Mm-hmm.
Now they can adjust in multiple different angles.
Yeah, I could see some people that love the Magic Keyboard using your case as almost like a commuter case to bring it to work.
Exactly.
Take it out of the case and
one,
put it on a stand.
Right, because it's now one
yep.
unit as well,
yep. mm-hmm.
right?
And then
so,
when they're at home, they can put it on their lap and
absolutely.
All that. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, because it for them, I think it's a no-brainer. My goal is not to convince other people who love, say, for example, the Apple keyboard or
mm-hmm.
even, you know, the Bridge keyboard, that hey, this is a better solution for you. I mean
yeah.
you know what's better for you. You know how the way to work. But if you even have the budget for, say, another case, there's nothing that says that you're only stuck to one.
Because a lot of keyboard cases, part of the cost is you're buying a keyboard.
Right.
Like in your case, there is no keyboard. That is the Magic
right.
keyboard.
Right.
So that allows you to have a lower price point.
Price point. Right.
Yeah.
And many people have a Magic Keyboard lying around, or
mm-hmm.
they can get a cheaper one off, say, even eBay.
Yeah.
Right. It just brings the price point down, and you have it, so why not?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. My target market is, you know, pretty well defined. I'm seeing a lot of interest, even on my current Kickstarter, from people like saying, I've been waiting for something like this for a long time.
Very cool. And that brings up the question, who is this not for?
Yeah. Speaking of the trade-off, so, you know, the Magic Keyboard was made for a desktop primarily,
mm-hmm.
right? And, I mean, you know, kudos to Apple. They really still made it super thin and light. But comparison to, say, Apple's keyboard, it's still a bit heavier.
Sure.
It's Bluetooth. It doesn't use the smart connector,
mm-hmm.
right? Yeah. And so it's not for the people who would say thin in portability matter to me above all else.
Yeah.
Right? Because it is a little bit heavier,
mm-hmm.
right? Of course, you get the additional features, but it all comes at that design trade-off.
Yeah.
I'd say if you want to have a keyboard with you all the time and you don't mind some of the drawbacks of Apple's solution, but really, really need it to be as light as possible, then go with that.
Yeah.
Because that, I think, will serve you better. And it's important that if everyone has the right keyboard solution for them, right? Mm-hmm. Or productivity solution for them, then that means iPad productivity on the whole increases. And if that increases, then the market increases. And if that increases, then Apple's attention and other accessory makers' attention on the iPad also increases.
Right.
So that's why I want everyone to have the best solution for them. And I'm not in the business of trying to convince someone to do something that may not actually be, you know, good for them in the long run.
Yeah. So taking the iPad in and out of the frame, is that something that you see people able to do with the frame holding up, or what do you expect?
Yeah,
there?
So that was a concern of mine, because I thought, like, you know, the frame has gotten pretty thin with the iPad.
Yeah.
And, you know, you have to bend it a little bit to pop it out.
Mm-hmm.
I've been shown and reassured by my manufacturers that the resin that they're using to make the actual shell is very forgiving.
Yeah.
It can withstand a lot of, like, putting in and putting out. And indeed, you know, the time I've had the case, and, you know, other people that have used it in the time have not uttered one complaint about that. They've also told me that this is the same shell, type of shell, you know, material that, again, other iPad case manufacturers use.
Yeah, and it certainly helps having the very top wide open.
Yeah.
So you can use that to prop it out.
Yeah, you can pop it out. And also, you'll notice at the bottom, there's these little, where the connector is for the keyboard, is if you put one thumb on that corner and put it on the opposite end, it actually makes it very easy to pop out.
Okay.
Compared to just, you know, the other iPad case that don't really give you much of a thing to hold on to.
Yeah. Now, what's your background with, you've mentioned back with the original iPad, you were designing cases for that.
Yeah.
Are you working in CAD, or how are you actually designing this to get to manufacturers and working with them? What's that process all like?
It's so different than what I'm used to, because as a user interface designer, I'm so used to just seeing something in my head, going to Photoshop or Sketch or, you know, Adobe XD and just, like, manifesting it.
Yeah.
And being done, right? You could just—it's literally.
Yeah, it's digital goods.
Yeah, it's just—it's such a wonderful feeling. But now, when you transition to the hardware world, you're limited. You need specialized tools. You need specialized materials. Not to mention super specialized expertise.
Yeah.
And, you know, experience. Like, oh no, that'll work. That won't work. There's something called design for manufacturing. Like, yeah, sure, you have a great idea, but can it be manufactured at scale at cost?
Right. A prototype's different from a final product.
Right. Mm-hmm. You know. So that has been a struggle for me when I wanted to make the transition, because I had to rely on others more, and others where I didn't have connections beforehand. So I was kind of, you know, cold calling out into the internet, and, you know, maybe through my naivete and, you know, being trusting, you know, would learn some lessons the hard way. So, for example, one lesson is if a company says they're a trading company, that means that they are not the manufacturer, that they are a middleman for the manufacturer. And their job is to mark up as much as possible and deliver you the least as possible so they have the highest return.
Right.
And that's, in fact, what happened to me with my first generation iPad case. I had specced out for a very high-grade Napa leather, very smooth, very soft, almost lambskin type of feel. And they sent me a sample with it, and I said, yes, I approved this. But when it came down to production, the leather they sent me was very different. It was rough. It almost looked like it was gray, and they had just painted it, you know, black with a brush stroke.
Right.
And yeah, so I had to, like, severely discount a lot of those. That was one experience. Then another experience was looking for red flags to see if the manufacturer you're dealing with is really invested in the project, or they're just after it just to humor you, or to, you know, to get their development costs.
Mm-hmm.
So one time when I was developing the case, I went out to China, and, you know, we said, okay, yeah, this is the prototype. Great. I said, based on this, what's the price? They said, well, we've checked with our partners and it's X amount. I said, oh, great. Okay. I can budget for that.
Yeah.
So then the new iPad Pro came out, like I think the 9.7 at the time, or maybe the 10.5. And I said, all right, let me go to China one more time and just, you know, update it for this new size. So I go out a few months later, and as soon as I land, and I go and I have my first meeting. First of all, the project manager's not there. He's AWOL. The engineer says, oh, did they tell you? And I said, no. I said, yeah, shortly after you left, we double confirmed the quote, and it's actually 3 times more expensive. And I was furious because they knew it, but they didn't bother to tell me before I flew out.
Yeah.
And looking back, I could see the red flags. I could see the lack of communication, the lack of interest. If they're not even getting the design, then it tells you that, yeah, there's something there. They're just biding their time. But I was also blessed to have those experiences because when you know when you find the right one, right?
Yeah.
Because it's like a breath of fresh air.
Right.
The manufacturers I'm working with now, in addition to creating cases for top name brands, they're also personally invested in the success, I feel. Mm-hmm.
They'll get more orders.
They get more orders, right. They will, you know, actively look at the Kickstarter campaign and say, great, we've crossed 800 backers. This is so wonderful, you know. Every step of the way, I will share mm-hmm. with them what's going on. And they feel like they're part of the journey as well. And that's what you want, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, so the process, to answer your question, has been a bit of a learning curve. I'm in a pretty good spot right now, I feel.
Yeah.
And I'm really looking forward to the future because, I mean, I may have just done this case, but the best thing is when you can give a creative person an outlet.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best thing you can do. Like if somebody, so now I have all these ideas I had placed on the back burner, I can now think about it, right? There's a possible solution for a unique type of, I'd say, let's say accessory for the iPad aimed at artists that I'm thinking of.
Yeah.
That's not in the market now, you know, because, you know, Photoshop is coming to the iPad and there's going to be more artists will be using as their workstation.
Yeah.
So I said, you know, there's other ideas out there. So I'm exploring that. Another accessory. So I'm really looking forward to seeing what's next.
Yeah. So I want to dive a little bit into Kickstarter. For those that want to make their own Kickstarter,
yeah.
if they have an idea,
yeah.
what's that process like? I want to start with the video. Videos are key to
right.
success, right?
Yeah.
What was your process for making that?
So the video, I had a choice, right? And everybody has the same choice,
mm-hmm.
is you can either pay someone else to do it.
Yep.
Or do it yourself.
Yeah.
Being a geek, I guess, it's very hard for me to turn down the opportunity to for the excuse to buy more stuff.
Sure, yeah.
You know. So I said, okay, so say I would have spent X amount of money on a firm,
yeah.
right? They would have done the video, but I wouldn't keep any of their
sure.
cool equipment,
yeah.
right? But if I keep that same budget, I can just, you know, get it myself and say, you know, try learning it myself.
Yeah.
You know, why not? Then mm-hmm. I have it. And what's neat about Kickstarter is that it's okay to be unpolished. In fact, it's an asset.
Right.
Because it allows people to connect with you, you know, mm-hmm. as the individual creator.
Yeah.
So if they see something that's a little bit rough around the edges or it could have been done better, it's actually a bit endearing.
Yeah.
So I had that going for me. Then when it came down to actually saying like what type of video I wanted to produce, I thought to myself that what videos out there, either within Kickstarter or outside of Kickstarter, do I hold up as like, yeah, that's a good video? And fortunately, again, it's not a surprise, Apple had come out with an amazing video introducing the iPad Pros. It was narrated by Phil Schiller.
Yeah.
And what I loved about it was the script and how every idea just naturally phased into the other.
Yeah.
And it just felt like a conversation. But yet it was engaging because every 2 seconds, there was a new frame on screen. So by the time the video is over, you're like, oh, it's already done. And that's like a 2.5 minute video.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, okay, it all starts with the script. It's not just the production quality, it's like the messaging. And when it comes down to creating a script, there's no other thing you can buy on Amazon or Apple that is going to make it better because the machinery we all have, it's our brain, it's our
yeah.
mind, right? Sure, there's different levels of experience, but you can feel then if something is right, similar, or not similar.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I did. I deconstructed their video. I wrote out all of their text, you know, so I could kind of feel the mind of the copywriter as they wrote out the text. I downloaded the video. I put into Final Cut. I actually recreated the cuts. I made the little clips of transition so I could
yeah.
see. All right, so this is a close-in shot. Okay, this is a wide shot. Okay, they're transitioning about every 2 seconds.
Mm.
And I said, those are my targets.
Yeah.
Did the script writing. And after you go through that, you fully imbibe the creator's mind.
Yeah.
And once you're in that flow state, then you create what you want to create.
Mm-hmm.
So I created the script, and it just naturally flowed as if Phil Schiller kept on talking and said, and this is the touch type case.
Yeah.
And yeah, so that was my idea.
Yeah. And that's your office where you're standing and speaking.
That's my office, like my basement office, actually. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe people say, you know, we did this in-house. Well, in my case, I literally did it in my house. Like, you'll notice, it's just me. I'm the model, right?
Yeah.
Sometimes on my sofa in the living room, sometimes on the dining room, sometimes the lights are on, sometimes the lights are off.
Yeah.
And that was actually a bit of a challenge. I mean, I wanted that. I mean, sometimes I thought, okay, maybe I should do it something outside the house. Like, no, I want it to be able to say I did it, you know, all in my house. Because it'd just be cool. You know, how often do you get a chance to do that?
So you mentioned gear. What kind of gear did you
get? Yeah. So I got the Sony A7 III for the camera.
Mm-hmm.
It's a fantastic camera for video blogging.
Yeah.
From what I've seen. It's full frame. At the same time, it's a fantastic camera.
Yeah.
So I built everything around that.
Okay.
Then I actually invested in lighting.
Mm-hmm.
So many people feel they can just, you know, cheap out on lights. You know, you can just, okay, just get a few lights here and there.
Yeah.
And yeah, you can, right? But if you can get a very nice color accurate light with a wide dome. In my case, I got the Aperture Light Dome 2, which softens the shadows and makes things look less harsh. And it's very color accurate so that you can dial it into Final Cut Pro or your camera so that everything's beautifully balanced. That just paid so many returns on the dividends. Other things I got were robotic sliders, right? Because part of cinematic movie making is motion.
Yeah.
And so I picked up, I think it's on Amazon. It was cheap. It was like maybe $600. I mean, relatively speaking, cheap.
Yeah.
GVM, Great Video Maker, I think. So they had this robotic slider where you can program, okay, I want it to go from here to here at this pace.
So the camera's moving.
The camera's just moving. And you can set it up so the camera also rotates while it moves.
Mm.
So you just set it on go, let it just keep moving. It has a remote control as well. And you just keep doing take after take after take.
Yeah.
And then within that take, you pull it in. Surely you would have caught something.
Right.
And you only need 2 seconds of it anyway.
Sure.
Yeah. So I used that. Had a gimbal as well, which was handy for some shots. Yeah, just got creative, you know?
Yeah.
Got a backdrop, got a light box, and tried to, again, like the iPad case, I tried to focus on items that were versatile, just like the camera, right? I mean, I could have got a separate camera for video and a separate camera for photo. I was like, no, what's the best camera that can do both?
Yeah.
You know, or the lighting and stuff. Like, where's the most versatile that'll give me the most bang for the buck?
Right. Any other Kickstarter tips for doing that successfully?
It's very essential that you have an audience before you get to Kickstarter.
Mm-hmm.
Because Kickstarter is a very different place from when I last did my first campaign in 2012.
Yeah.
You're competing with many more active campaigns, and you'll very quickly get buried if you don't have a base.
Yeah.
So I'd recommend, as much as you can, try to create a prototype, try to reach out to even, you know, press. Like, they might be interested, if not covering the case, at least say, hey, are you going in the right track?
Yeah.
Then once you have that, create a landing page where you can show off some of your ideas. In my case, I said, do you want to know the second it gets launched and grab the, you know, early bird 50% discount that I had?
Well,
then give me your email address.
Right.
You get people who are actively involved, and on that day one, you validate your product and you'll have a good first day pull.
Yeah, and your landing page, it's very professional. And the logo, is that something you made back in 2012, or is that a newer one?
Okay. It is. Yeah, the logo is interesting. So if you, for those, you know, who can't see, the logo is like a square, and it has all, it's like these alternating black and white lines.
Yeah.
But if you look closely, it's actually the letter T.
I noticed that, yeah.
Yeah. And the letter T obviously coming from the alliteration of touch type.
Yeah.
But it's a square, and it's symmetrical both horizontally and vertically, because I knew that if I was putting on an iPad, the iPad itself would often be shown in different, you know, on a case, it would be shown in different orientation.
Sure. Yeah.
And I wanted it to, just like the iPad, you'd never know which, there's no wrong way to hold it.
Yeah.
I wanted the same for the logo.
Okay.
You know, to kind of be a homage to the design philosophy of the iPad itself.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
So the Kickstarter's got another day or so left in it. And then what's the next steps for you after the Kickstarter's over?
Yeah, so what's typical now is after Kickstarter ends is then you transition to Indiegogo, something called Indiegogo In Demand.
Yeah.
Where you can continue to raise funds. There's still a bit of a discount.
Mm-hmm.
You can continue to, you know, generate interest and as you go to manufacturing. And typically it's after once people collect the funds that they start the manufacturing process. They go to China or wherever and start making and posting updates. In my case, I'm very careful in the deadlines I give. I know I gave an August delivery deadline, which, you know, many people have told me is very aggressive.
Yeah.
I'm hoping to prove them wrong. So I've actually started the golden sample process. What that means is I've given, based on the feedback from reviewers, I've made whatever small improvements I could make. For example, some people said, you know what, the magnets could be stronger between the keyboard and the iPad case. So I've made them stronger. Actually, the strongest that is available in China. Now they're preparing the golden sample. So in a few days, it'll be shipped to me. I will review it. Hopefully, if all looks good, then I will provide sign-off and they will start, you know, tooling.
Yeah.
And, you know, ready to go. So yeah, so manufacturing, and then hopefully, you know, by August, all these backers will have a touch type in their hand and it'll exceed their expectations.
Yeah, awesome. And have you thought what would be the process like to get in a Best Buy or something like that?
Yeah, so I've actually asked about this. To getting in a Best Buy, there's two routes. Mm-hmm. One is you can, you know, try to get connected to a Best Buy buyer, right?
Yeah.
Maybe through LinkedIn or, you know, some other method. But a more easier approach is to approach one of Best Buy's distributors.
Okay.
Because they're always meeting with Best Buy and showing new products. So it's their best interest to try to introduce another product to them. But it's very difficult, from my understanding, to just go directly to a large retailer because they typically work on what's called consignment,
mm-hmm.
which means that they'll make a huge order and you have to front the money for that order. And and then you see the money like down the road. So
right.
if you don't have much cash flow, it's very difficult to float. So I'm going to give myself a little bit of time to get more established, get some solid reviews on Amazon and here, mm-hmm. you know, address, you know, concerns. And then once I'm in a good position, then maybe approach the larger retailers.
Yeah. What's your experience with iPad and your workflow? How does it play a part in your work?
Yeah. So as I mentioned before, I'm primarily an artist.
Mm-hmm.
So I use the iPad for, you know, coming up with logo iterations, for example, or a storyboard. I love the new Apple Pencil for that reason.
What are your favorite apps for
Procreate is my favorite.
Yeah.
You know, it's I'm able to go in there. I get my layers. I get my transparency. It feels very Photoshop-like in certain respects. So I use. I also use Linea for, you know, quickly jotting down, you know, ideas and something that maybe I just want to, conceptualize something.
Sure.
Not create like a finished product as I would use for.
And they've got great templates for icons, for instance.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, you can make anything, you know, there. It's just like, just treat it like paper.
Yeah.
And I actually like the constraints it gives you. So you're not kind of, you know, you're like, oh, should I do this with that? Should I do this effect? You're like, no, just treat it like paper and you'll be fine.
Yeah. <You know? laughs> And do you gravitate towards the larger one or the 11 inch or what's your...
Yeah, I'm more partial to the larger one now.
Yeah.
Before I wasn't because...
The bezels. The size. Yeah.
The bezels, right? But now that it's the same size as the keyboard and, you know, for drawing, you want all the space you can get.
Yeah.
You know, and as part of my job, I treat it as a business expense having to buy every single iPad that comes out.
Right.
You know, so I might as well just go with, you know, I could take my pick. I guess whatever I feel like on the day. But yeah, I gravitate to the larger one.
Yeah, very cool. And anything else you want to share about the touch type or anything else?
I think we covered everything, most everything. What I do want to say is, you know, to the backers or the people who choose to get a touch type Pro, either now or, you know, down the line, is that I'm very open to feedback. This is a constant journey. I want to do like Apple and, you know, really try to improve and iterate the product generation over generation. And this is just my toe in the water, if you will.
Yeah.
And if there are certain things, you know, you'd like to see or some things that can be improved or even things that you love, you know, so I know what to keep doing, you know, you can easily email me to my website, touchtypecase.com, and or, you know, reach me on Twitter. And yeah, I'd love to just develop a, you know, a relationship in that regard.
Great. Thank you so much for your time today. It's been really great chatting about this.
It was a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Thanks for listening to this episode of iPad Pros. You can find the show notes over at ipadpros.net. You can send your feedback to me at ipadprospodcast@gmail.com. If you email a voice memo, I'd be happy to include your audio in a future episode. I'm on Twitter at ipadprospodcast. And as mentioned at the top of the show, if you haven't had a chance to review the show on Apple Podcasts, I'd highly encourage you to do so. Every review helps send signals to promote the podcast more in search and helps other people discover the show. Thank you for your time and attention today. Talk to everyone again real soon.